How?
Mm-hmm.
So, how we measure gene expression, or more exactly, messenger RNA concentration. So, the way I tell the story is first, what is the question? I can tell you many stories of when we do this, like in the people who, I mean, kind of my main work when my main contribution when I work with people doing experiment is that I ask this question: what is the question that you want to solve? That is, even when people came to me like, professor, I want to do this. How I do this in the computer? Like I always go like, what do you want to do? And in many cases, you find that they are trapped in one solution, but there are easier ways to know to solve the question. So, what's the real question that you? So, in this case, okay, the real question depends on the experiment. Let's say I will imagine that Hassan may want to, since he was growing plants in different environment conditions, you would like to know which genes reacted to different pH, for example, or maybe he know one particular gene and he want to know how much it changed and what other genes are connected to question like that. But since we don't know the general question that we are going to handle now is like the one that I put in the screen. You already know which genes, how much, and how they change either with time, with conditions, or between cell lines. Okay. If you anything that you have not asked any question beyond the domestic questions, but ask questions. Okay. So the big assumption that we are making here is that the protein concentration is proportional to the messenger concentration. This is a topic that eventually people sooner or later claimed. You know, I have seen papers because from time to time I get papers to review and I see my comment and I see the comment of other people. And one of the comments that some reviewers say that if you measure messenger, you cannot prove that these are proteins. The concentration of messenger, the concentration of proteins, they are not necessarily the same thing. And that is true, but it's kind of we cannot do better. No? So we apply what will say the Nasreddin theorem. No? You know, Jemre knows, no, what I'm saying with
I forget it
No, but
again.
there is I have it somewhere. I don't have the slide, but there is a story of, in fact, a very common story, but in Turkey it's known as a story from Nasreddin Hoca. And they essentially say that it is late in the night and he's looking for the keys, you know. There's people in the street and they find what are you doing? What you are in the ground? I'm looking for the keys of my house. I lost my keys, or I don't know. And everybody start looking for the keys and they cannot find them. But are you sure that you lose them here? No, I lose in the other street. But why are you looking them here? Because there is more light here. So we do the thing that are easier to solve, not necessarily the one that are the correct ones. So this is the same. We are measuring the thing that we can measure because it's cheaper, but it's not what we really want to do. There is this point. So it's a big assumption, and in most cases it's a good one, but sooner or later you will find one case that someone will say, okay, the gene expression and the protein concentration are not related. I mean, it depends. Well, you know, no, degradation of RNA, degradation of protein, and so on and so on. Anyway, so the big assumption is, well, I think I put this in. I repeated this thing. Ah, no, because which genes are being expressed. Here is the first slide, I say which genes, also which genes are being transcribed. So we change expression by transcription. And the assumption that if you have the messenger, you will have the protein and the thing that will happen. So how you, I am going to go very quickly from here, and I welcome any feedback you have in the next slides, okay? So first is that the basic way that I know, at least to measure RNA concentration, are qPCR, microarray, and RNA-seq. Yes. Maybe there are others, but I will guess that these are the dominant one now, no? Maybe there are some other technique. So, Sara, do you agree? Or Hassan, do you agree? I am missing something here about measuring.
I'm completely agree.
Okay. Okay, I am not missing anything. I am not saying something that is not true. I mean, I may miss something, but these are clearly tools that measure messenger RNA concentration, and they are widely used. Maybe there are others, and I will tell you more. There will be others. The problem that that we face when we teach this thing is that technology change quickly. I mean, when I learned these things, RNA-seq didn't exist. I learned this in the time that the microarray was the super new thing. And I will tell, okay, I will not tell you, but there are things that used to be super important 10 years ago, and they are absolutely irrelevant now, and new things happen. So that is why I don't like to focus too much in the specific technique, because in the, I don't know, 40 years that you will be working, you know, that, I mean, I don't know how old you are, but I will guess you are in your 20s, and I will guess that you will work until your 60s, maybe more. And so it means that, I mean, you probably become conscious of yourself after your teenage, so you have like 10 years of memory. Probably you don't remember very much of your childhood, but let's say that you have in front of you like 4 or 5 times what you have behind you. So you are starting. Even I am starting, and I started many years before. Anyway, point is that technology will change, and I will like you to teach you how to use technology that has not yet been invented. Okay, that is always the challenge. How can we teach you for the next one? So, well, we cannot exactly do that, but we can teach the general ideas. And on the other side, to teach general idea, we have to be very specific. We will use the tools of today to learn the philosophy behind, and learning the philosophy will hopefully help you to understand the next one. So, for example, in my case, I learn microarrays, and I am translating microarrays logic to RNA-seq logic. It's not the same, but there are many things that are common. So, one point that I want to say here, that the what we really measure here, what is the raw data? One of my points is that raw data is the most important part, is the most holy part. You do the experiments, and you get one result, and that result is the hardest to get again. You can do all the deduction, all the computations later, but you need to keep the raw data, the original thing that came from the machine. So the raw data in this case is the CT value, let's say, or if you like, the curves, probably the raw data is the curves of the luminescence. I have seen experiment. I mean, I saw an experiment that has some result, and when I saw the curves that should be like this, and they were like, so I'm not sure if the experiment was good, if the curves didn't follow the shape that you expect them, something happened. So you have to keep the raw data. But let's say for this, the raw data is the CT value. Everybody understand what we mean here, no? What is the CT value, no?
Actually, I do not.
Ah, good, good. So, but you know how qPCR works?
Yes, I do.
So you have a curve. So there is the what is the cycle transition or what is the something like cycle transition. The point is like you are essentially counting how many PCR cycles you need to cross a threshold. You have a threshold that's say half or maybe 10%, and when the curve crosses, that is the CT point. So how many cycles of PCR you need to get to some optical density threshold. Fine?
Yeah,
I forgot what is the literal meaning, but that is the point that you get. My point is that qPCR is not giving you the concentration directly. You have to compare this CT value with some reference. You know, you put several dilutions and you measure the CT value for everybody, and then you put your result in between them, and then since you have the dilutions, you know where you are, no?
Mm-hmm.
Agree? Good. Then the next philosophy is this southern, northern, western, eastern, up, down blot. That initially were done just for detecting, like you amplify things and you see a spot radioactive or not. So, and this eventually evolved to be these macro arrays and micro arrays. And so, you know the story of why they are called southern, northern, and western blots, no?
Yeah.
Yes?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. Hassan, no?
I've done it once, but I do not remember it completely.
No, the name, I don't know the technique. I'm just telling you the story. That the first guy who invented something, his family name was Salter, so Mr. Salter. So when people developed new techniques following the same idea, they play with the name and they call, okay, you did Southern, we are going to do Northern. And then the next one we call Western. And they were, there is even Northwest and things like that. But so, yeah, putting names is hard. So people say, okay, the Newton method or the Pythagoras theorem. But so they were more playful here. Anyway, microarray, it's a better name. And the point is, what is the raw data here? You have a luminescence or a light intensity in different colors. I here say wavelength, but colors, okay? Mm-hmm. So you mark your sample with different fluorophores that will give you a signal that you can measure in a specific frequency, so you know that you are looking at the correct one or not. And one of the points that this is measuring in some kind of arbitrary unit because you scan it with a scanner. I will talk about this later because I don't think it's super central, but I will show you later. The point is that you have a scanner, and the scanner essentially for every pixel has 16 bits. So you get a number depending on the amplification, what is the name, the gain. You have a photomultiplier, and you have a gain, and you have this different parameter that you can change. And you get a number between 0 and 64 kilo, okay? Two to the power of 16, okay? 16 bits. That is kind of the resolution that you get. And but essentially, the point is that if you don't have any intensity, the number will be 0. If you have like full intensity, 100%, you get this number. Okay, and you will get a number, an integer number in between. That, of course, we can normalize, and there's something that will be transformed later. So, last technology that we will talk is RNA-seq. In fact, I want to start with this one because I kind of think that is easy to understand. I mean, the technology is less noisy, let's say. So the raw data here are something that we call SAM or BAM files, but probably there is even one before that. When you sequence, you get the RNA-seq will sequence the RNA, and this will be a file with sequence. The typical format of this is called FASTQ. I don't know if you have seen them. So again, okay, SAM, BAM, and FASTQ. The number that we are going to work is essentially the number of reads per gene, how many fragments of DNA of a messenger you get, and normalized by gene length, of course, because I mean, if you have a long gene, you will have more fragment. If you have a short gene, you will have less fragment, essentially, because longer genes have more fragments, no? So, how we are going to get this data? So, I have some old data, but the point is that I used to work in project that before they were published. So I have some data that I cannot necessarily share with you. So I was looking for data that I can share. And the point is that when people publish, this data is published in some website. I know, well, there are more than, and I'm, but these are the ones that I know a little better, let's say, is NCBI GEO, Gene Expression Omnibus. Okay? Do you know this thing? Is new to you or not?
I know NCBI.
Yeah, NCBI?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
GEO,
yeah,
but I know
that. Okay, yeah. These are the two parts. One is what is NCBI and what is NCBI GEO. What can I say? Not this one. Here. Let me see. This is NCBI GEO. So it's a gene expression omnibus. It's the part of NCBI. You know what is NCBI. And the, yeah, we can close this message because we knew that. And we will like to take data from here. So there are some words here, dataset series platform. So okay, let me say, okay, my point is that we have public data. We have data that have been published before, and therefore it has been get experimentally. This is true. This is not simulated data. This is not a fantasy. This is real data that someone else paid for us. Just to give you an idea, we have some data. I have a table with 2,000 experiments. 1,000 experiments. Every experiment, every microarray, at that time at least, were costing like $1,000. That means that this matrix with 1,000 experiments, 1,000 is $1 million. Maybe a little more because, but let's say $1 million easily. So clicking here, you will get millions of dollars in data for free. So I think it's useful. And again, the point is that if you are going to do your own experiment, you will like first to know if someone else did it before. If you can find your experiment done, you don't need to do it again. And second, if you still want to do, you want to know more or less what is the range of things, what is happening here, what are the expected result. So the thing that we want to see, and I show you in the slide a minute ago in the webpage, we have this keyword, platform, sample, series, dataset, and profile. The platform essentially is which kind of slide you use in the microarray, which genes you have, in which order they are, what are the controls. So let's say that I don't have a slide here, but let's say that this is a microarray slide and they have some genes in some order. If I use the same physical slide or the same a copy of the same slide for a different experiment or a different instance of the same experiment, I can compare them. They have the same genes, the same controls in the same order. So If, on the contrary, I am comparing this with something, I don't have anything else, but they have a different one, let's say this one, different order, then they are much harder to compare. So knowing which are the oligos that you are using, which are the primers that you use, which are the controls, and which order, and the number of reps, all the things tends to be relevant. So one platform is used for one or more samples. Okay, then an experiment, there are two things that we can experiment. Maybe that is the point. Let's say that you want to measure a concentration of genes in different time development. So you have like 0 hours, 24 hours, 48 hours, three times, let's say. So. And you have an array to measure that. So you extract RNA at 0 hours, 24, 48. And you make the experiment. So let's say the hybridization. So one hybridization is going to give you one sample that we got here. Okay. But the experiment, the global experiment, is the three times. And to be honest, everybody will say you need replicas. So you will have, I don't know, four replicas for every time you measure the RNA, four times in time zero, four times in time 24 hours, and four times in 48 hours. So you in total have 12 samples that make one serie. Okay, that is your experiment. So in fact, I probably will make this mistake I'm telling now, because this is a typical mistake, and I tend to do that mistake. There are two things that we call experiment. One is a single hybridization, or you want a single RNA extraction. That, think of that. How many RNA extraction do you do? Okay. One RNA extraction that until you measure it, either with PCR or RNA-seq, that is one sampling, if you like, or one extraction. Sometimes I will say one experiment, but I am wrong. The real experiment is the complete series. It's all the RNA extraction from the same subject through all the conditions that you want to do. It can be different time, different exposure to light, to salt, to whatever, or different even varieties like Hassan did with the different GMO or so. So I am guessing from what Hassan described. Then there is another point that they call data sets. And when I check it now, I realize that there is an interesting point. Data set is something made by NCBI, in which they took data that can be compared. Essentially, if you have different people doing different experiments, but they use the same platform, you can compare them. Because they have the same array, and the genes are in the same position, the oligos are the same position, the controls are the same. So, I mean, there is probably the technical conditions are the same, and it makes sense to compare them. Then, when you have that condition, you can choose what here the Kaya profile. You have one gene, and you want to follow that particular gene through all possible conditions. You want to know when the gene is overexpressed, underexpressed, and so on. Sometimes, for example, you have two genes and you want to see if they are correlated. For example, they go up together, they go down together. So these are essentially three objects. No, one is the platform. Essentially, what are the genes that you are measuring? What are the rows? Then the names of the row, let's say. Then the samples, going back one slide, the sample, every column. And the series are group of columns. And data set, again, group of columns. And finally, profiles are kind of following one row. That is different. Like every data set is a series of columns, and profiles are rows. okay, in a big matrix that we will eventually get. And there is something that I realized when I was preparing the classes, that when you have series, sometimes people do several sampling and they use different platforms. For example, in a series, you may have a first set of samples that you use microarray. And with the microarray, you identify some genes that are interesting. And then in a second part of your serum experiment, you use qPCR to validate these genes. Because we will see qPCR is not very high precision. It will tell you if something going up or down, but if you want to make sure, you have to do qPCR at the end. Mm-hmm. So sometimes you find that one series can have more than one platform. So on the other side, data set, they kind of guarantee that you have only one platform, okay? So then this is something from this page. Oh, I put it wrong here. Anyway, but this is the document. And it has a drawing that I want to stop a second, and they show the relationship. I like this picture because the drawing here has a meaning. This symbol, you can Google them, let's say. Essentially, you say that this is a one, if you like. This is a zero. And these are many. You have three, if you see it. So it means this. One platform can go to many samples. One platform can be used in many samples. But one sample, each sample has only one platform. It's one too many. And it can be zero. You can have a platform that was never used. You can have a platform without samples. That is why you have zero too many. But one sample, one platform, many samples. Several samples go to zero or more series. You can have the sample in one series, but you can have another series. Since a series is a set of samples, you can mix them the way that you like. It also means implicitly that since you have different samples, you can have samples from different platforms in a series. And then data sets and profile are not so directly, they are kind of processed here. They allow you to make these things. Here you are following one gene through different conditions, and here you are following, different conditions. But the point is that since the genes are the same, you have this matrix, full matrix, and you can make this heat map things. Okay? Now, the type of file that we are going to find. These are going to, at this stage, we are going to find mostly files, no computer files. In this part of the class, let's say in this part of the course, we are going to speak about computers and computer files that are going to be the results that you can get from the web. And let's be optimistic. If you do your own experiment, you have to prepare these kind of files. You will get these files. So when I was working in this thing, I used to work with GPR files, GenePix, if I am not wrong. I have some material that I will put a link in the description below, in the homepage. And then Affymetrix, they have their own format, depending on the technology. And the scanner give you different kind of file. Then when you are doing RNA-seq, you will have the raw data from the RNA-seq is FASTQ files. And then when you compare them and you find them, because the FASTQ file will tell you the sequence of the messenger, let's say, or part of it. And to identify it, you have to look in which part of the genome, you have a reference genome, and you will find which part of the genome got this sequence. That is given in a file that is either Sam or Bam. We will eventually talk about this. So these are kind of the starting points. Then, as you see, there's a big variety depending on what you are using. And I didn't put anything about QPCR here because I don't know. But eventually, they will get so to some kind of format that the one that we see in CVI. Let me show you. And that's why we have here that page. So, for example, I have this one. I have maybe I should have said. Let me go back one step. Here, every one of these object, platform, sample, and series, and every one of them has a ID number, an identification, in Turkish people call kimlik, your passport number, if you like. This is something that is super, super important, and I am surprised that people in molecular biology don't get off this enough. Everything needs to have a name, and the name should be unique, and the name should be kind of clear to everybody, a serial number or something. What happened it is, let's say, when you go around Turkey, you will have many people. For example, we had a student, Burcu Yılmaz, and then I met a professor in another university, same name. And it happened that you find people with the same name a lot. There is a lot of what we call name collision, we will call. So, and that is a problem because if I say, I don't know, Cemre Kefeli, I would like to point to the same person and not to a different person with the same name. You need to make sure that the names are unique. So the way that people solved that problem in the 50s is to give everything a serial number. That serial number, in this case, have a certain protocol. Let me show you here. These are called accession numbers in CVI. You probably know from the sequence. But if they say GSE is GO series, and there's a serial number. Okay, so this is a series. Let me close this. No, we cannot close it. So this series in particular has one platform. So the platform also has an ID, GPL. Okay. And it has 34 samples, GSM. So SM, sample, PL, platform, SA series, then we have DS, I think. Well, but data sets, and so they also have these three letters that will allow you to recognize what kind of object they are, and then some serial number. You even see the projects, they also have an ID. Everything has an ID. And it's a very good practice that you assign IDs to your things and in a way that is easy to replicate. So, what happened is this. People say, I took a sample of the bacteria, or say, I took a sample of the plant. Which plant? Well, that plant, or I don't know, plant A. And some people say, it's not plant A, it's plant one. So it's one or A. So. And when you say plant one, and then you have another experiment, and you also have a plant one, which is plant one. So it should be a name that should be kind of universal. Nobody else should have the same name for a different object. So in this case, if I say GSA 59885, everybody will agree that we are talking about the same thing. Okay. Putting names to things is important. So let me show you a couple of things here. First, the raw data here, and was the reason why I choose this one, are these GPR files. And I may have opened some of them here, but let me see if I can show you. So you eventually, you see the size here and you can click different ways to download and you can download and they have different files. So you will notice that these files are not Excel files or not Word files. And there is a reason for that because they should not be used with Excel. They should not be used with Word. We normally use different tools for this. Unfortunately, most people don't get taught how to use these tools. So my advice, strong advice, is to learn to use good tools. Something that is not Office, let's say. Office is software for lawyers, maybe for journalists, not for scientists. Okay. If you need, you can write a paper in Word. I don't recommend, but you can. But you should not use Word for data. It's certainly not for data. Excel, you can use for data, but you have to be very careful because Excel is trying to be more smart than you. I will give you a specific example later, but I think today we have enough. And then you have these files. These are the files that they propose. This is something they call soft formatted file, MindML formatted file, and series matrix. Well, I may try to download. In fact, I have something here. Maybe it's not the same, but here I have one of these. It's not the same series, but it's just to give you an idea. There is this soft file that I can try to download here. The mini ML, and the series matrix, and the raw data. And this is the one that contains the GPR files. So, okay, this is just to scare you, okay? This is not really what we are going to do, at least not at the beginning, but just to give you an idea of what are we talking here. This is how you see a GPR file. Let me... But very briefly, there is a header here. I will give you more details later, but here you see some input. We will talk about this later. The point is, after some generic data, you get a matrix here, and you have the column names are here, block, column, row name. They have different lengths here, so they are not easy to see in this format. But well, again, we are going to solve that later. And numbers here that we eventually will process. So as you see, this is not necessarily easy to read. We can open in Excel. If you want, you can open Excel, but it will be a little better for us right now to, instead of working with the raw GPS data, to work with something like this series matrix or the soft file. You should be able to download them and maybe opening them. Let's see if I can show you how we are doing. We are finishing. So, in fact, let me show you the last slide. Homework. Learn how to do this thing. Learn how to read this file. Internet is full. Yeah, see, this is the other one. This is the one that I get from CVI. And I'm saying that this is the matrix file. You see, series matrix. This is the kind of thing that we are going to use. There is, again, some blah, blah, blah at the beginning, and then a matrix with the data. And this maybe this can be read in Excel, okay? So you have a different sample. You see every column a different sample and a number. So next slide, what we are going to do with this, we are going to take this data and take a look from something at this level, at the level of a document that is already processed. We are going to, in general, get data from the geo. We are going to get this series matrix or the soft file. We have to see. I give you like homework to see if you can learn about this one and see if you can see. Because, I mean, it will be very bad if you cannot see the data. Okay?
It's going to be a homework for next time?
Well,
I have to prepare for you.
Technically, you don't need to finish next class, but it will not be good if you don't do it sooner or later. Now, my goal, as I say, is to... let's separate into things. Because I have two questions, and I think that it's urgent that you need to download this data and be able to see it, okay? You can use Excel, but at least be able to download them and compress them, because they are compressed and you may not have the correct compressor, and open them, at least with Excel. What I recommend, in fact, is something like Visual Studio Code. We will see that. Find what Google says you that. The second question, we can take more time, because there is a European database. I am biased because I know the American one, but the European have another database. And I say write in English because I strongly believe that people should write in English every day. So, okay, let's do this way. This homework doesn't need to be delivered, but you let's say that you should be able, for next week, you should be able to get the data and see it, okay?
Okay.
In a couple of weeks, I would like you to explain me how to get data from the European database. I don't know, and I want to know. So, since my problem is this, I already used something, so I have to unlearn the American to learn the European, and that is hard. Since you don't have any bias, since you are fresh on this, since you are new, you can learn the European without learning the American, and I will be fine with that. I will be more than fine. I will be happy if you teach me how to use the European. Okay?
Okay.
And it doesn't need to be for the next week, but it doesn't need to be for the end of the year, no? Fine. Well, that is the class.